my role here is to basically introduce the theme for the designathon. That broadly, the theme is about how can we make rapid urbanization sustainable in order to sort of leverage design to make human progress much more sustainable than it currently is today. I've been in the field of design since 94 when I joined the design college, which was NID. And design as a field has come a long way. And I thought I'll take a few minutes to acknowledge that. The reason why I want to say that is because it has taken a really, really long time for the entire community and the entire society to realize that design has a role to play in directing where human evolution will lead to, in directing where the development should be happening, in deciding the path for the future. So, there were three reasons I thought I would like to thank Team Dell. The first reason was to acknowledge the role of designers and design in shaping the future, which I think is a really, really big thing for any corporate to realize at the highest level and acknowledge it by actually having us come together. The second is actually organizing this entire location and a space for all the designers to come together and actually try to solve certain problems which we all face. And the third reason is because of the theme, which is urbanization. Now, as much as we like it, we are all a part of Bangalore, and you know, whether we like it or not, the city is the way it is. For the most part, if I were to ask any one of you and ask you what is the kind of change you would like to make to the city and what kind of change do you think you can make possible, on a day-to-day basis, when you're actually going through the traffic, facing the potholes, you know, getting stuck in your cars and bikes on flooded streets, the answer is that maybe I really can't do much. But the problem seems really enormous. So I think I appreciate the fact that Dell has chosen to actually leverage design and design thinking to take on an area which is rapid urbanization and have the entire design community and a lot of you from different fields actually look at it and inspect it and see if we can contribute something to a field like this, to a problem like rapid urbanization, through our expertise. So those were the three reasons I thought we need to acknowledge Dell for. This is the theme. We're basically looking at enabling human progress through design for sustainable urbanization. And before, while I was sort of preparing for the presentation, I thought, let's examine the word urbanization in slightly greater detail. Urbanization is like a, you know, it's a concept. So basically, as it turns out, for the longest time, humans have found many reasons to stay together, right? So if you sort of take all the humans and spread them across the world uniformly, chances are that they will try to come together in groups because it actually helps them. And it has happened, not right now, it's not a recent phenomenon. It has been happening since there were humans. So it's a tendency of people to come together. Now, once they come together, it obviously the spaces evolve from small gatherings to villages to cities, and they become larger as more and more people join in. It's like a loop. It reinforces itself. So people keep coming, it gets better, and more people want to join in. Actually, you know, urbanization contributes to 80% of world GDP. So if you look at urban centers and look at the kind of business impact they create in terms of economics and business and so on, it's rather substantial, it's 80%. And basically what ends up happening is there's these cities that are bringing large groups of people together which obviously stimulates creativity, right? So people are coming together and meeting other people. So without the cities, you know, you wouldn't have so many people to talk to and bounce your ideas off each other. It would lead to higher creativity, leads to better problem solving and increase in productivity, and therefore economic growth. So as much as we are well aware of the negative impacts of urbanization, we need to acknowledge that urbanization is critical. We will go now and get warmed up into a different aspect, and sort of the idea of these slides is to actually warm you up and show you a different side of urbanization, slightly quantitative side of urbanization, some statistics here and there, just to make things interesting. I do not think I need to sort of explain what it means to live in a city to any one of you. I think all of you understand what is the good side of staying in a city and what's the bad side of staying in a city. But nonetheless, you know, just to give a sort of a backdrop to this entire exercise. So right now we are close to about 50% urbanized worldwide. That figure is going to shoot up to about 70 to 80% by 2050. And the reason I put this up is there is statistical evidence that we are headed in that direction and not the other way. If people are thinking that, oh, nowadays people want to go back to the villages, statistics are not saying that. Statistics have shown us that urbanization is true and it's coming, and it's going to be the biggest thing. By 2050, almost 70 to 80% of people will be living in cities. Closer to home, 500 families are added to Bangalore every day. So that number was a bit staggering for me. I found it very difficult to believe that there are 500 families getting added to Bangalore every day. Every single day. As much as we may want to curse everything around us, the fact is that 500 families are coming every day. And every day these families keep coming. I'm not saying that they are going to cause slums. I've just interspersed these statistics with some images which just may create some sort of connection in your head. It's a design thinking workshop, so just painting a broader picture. Back in 2005, I couldn't get a you know, the recent statistic. Many jobs are being created in Bangalore, right? So it's a self-reinforcement happening right here. A lot of people are migrating because there are jobs. Because people are coming, there are more jobs and so on. Obviously, it is going to lead to a growth in built-up area, right? People need spaces to stay. They're obviously going to come. Roads will have to be built. Homes will have to be built. And obviously, you will see something like this. So the red part is your built-up area. And you can see why it used to be called Green Bangalore. And why it's not being called Green Bangalore anymore. Because, you know, so that is how, what was the built up area in 1973. And that's projected about 2016 already looks like this. Right, so it's, the green cover is, it's practically gone. Vegetation is out, the water bodies are all gone. And so that's the scenario. That's what happens when 500 families come to Bangalore every day. There's a 78% decline in green cover. I'm sure we are quite used to this because it feels like there is not a single street which doesn't have anything under construction. There's construction all around us, everywhere, and it doesn't seem to stop. So it's a moving target, no matter what you design. So if you design a road for today, it's going to be obsolete tomorrow. And the road you design for tomorrow is probably going to be obsolete for the day after. So it's a moving target and will require us to think a bit differently. So we've got, so out of 261 lakes, we're left with 25, right? And then sometimes this happens, right? So a lot of things are happening. Some of them are interconnected directly, some of them are not interconnected. I'm not trying to make a big issue out of why we should save lake or why we shouldn't save lake. I'm saying these are paradigms that we live in. Some of them are interconnected to each other, some of them have cause and effect kind of relationship, some of them don't. Okay, so since 1974, we've got a 60-fold increase in vehicles, 60 times the number of vehicles. And as against that, there's only a 12-fold increase in the roads, the surface area of the roads. So this is a simple statistic to say that obviously there is some sort of a lag between the rate at which the vehicles are getting added to the roads and the rate at which the roads are built. A small statistic that I'd like to add to this is that the traffic police grew by 90 times. So that's one positive side of things. So we can see that at least the traffic police and the number of people they have is keeping pace with the growth in the number of vehicles in the same time period. Again, something that we have gotten used to, gotten numb to, we found our solutions through this. Water is a really big concern in Bangalore, and I'm sure everyone knows about it. You cannot emphasize on this problem more. It's a huge problem. Strangely enough, in the we live in information age, and there's all kinds of statistics moving around, right? About how, where the groundwater is, where it's going to be in the future. A lot of people say that it's a political problem. A lot of people say that, you know, it's the government that is moving slowly. As a normal citizen, I know that we have water shortage. That's just the simple fact. And, you know, there are all these kind of statistics moving around. And I do see a lot of water tankers all over the place. And there is genuine concern about whether we're going to have water in the future or not. And I do not know what the solution is. It's probably something that we need to think about. This is a very, very common sight in Bangalore. You know, I think most of you guys would be seeing these tankers come to your homes. This is an interesting statistic. By 2020, Bangalore will run out of groundwater. So all the bore wells that are being dug, they're going to run dry by 2020 because the water table keeps sinking. And this is something that was put out by the CIO. We all know trees are being cut. If one looks at the amount of oxygen a human being needs, the other carbon related dependency, a human ratio to a tree ratio should be 1:2. So right now it's actually reverse, it's 7:1, right? So obviously the trees are needed and the green cover is lacking. Okay, 3,000 tons of solid waste is generated per day. Now that per se is a random statistic, but when you compare that statistic to the amount that is actually being collected and processed, you can see that 2/3 of the waste we generate has nowhere to go. No one be collecting it, and no one actually addressing it in a proper sustainable way. It's not getting processed. So that's a staggering amount that is just lying there on a daily basis, right? Just staggering amount, 2,000 tons. And it's going to stay there. It's not going to magically disappear by itself. It will stay there, right? While we hear all of these stories, you know, my idea was to actually create some sort of a mood and some sort of an intent within us to try to address some of these issues to whatever extent possible. I also found some interesting stories. that I thought it'll be nice to share, just to share what are the kinds of things that are happening. I do not claim to know these stories inside out. These are some stories that I've personally interacted with. This is not just purely picked out of media. I've personally interacted with, so I know that there is some truth to what they're talking about. This was a very interesting story. It was a pilot. Basically, as you all know, in Bangalore some time ago, government made waste segregation mandatory, right? And everyone was trying to segregate waste, most of us were, in whatever ways we could understand. But what they realized was that there were two, three issues. One, there were certain people who didn't want to do it. There were others who wanted to do it, but did not know what the right way was. So there was, and all of that base getting mixed up, and obviously there are the others who are saying, if they're not doing it, I'm not going to do it. So that entire loop of not having feedback of what is the right thing to do was creating a breakdown in the system itself. Now, what these people did was a very smart thing. The Purnamikas who collect the garbage, they equipped them with an app, and the residents got, so this was a pilot they ran in Dombluur. They gave the residents garbage bags with the QR code on them, so that the Purnamikas knew where the garbage bag was coming from. And the people who were collecting the waste, they were supposed to simply rate the quality of segregation on a household level. Now, all of a sudden, what ended up happening, the residents started getting feedback on the quality of segregation they were doing. So all of a sudden, on a daily basis, they realized that these days we did well, other days we didn't do well. And the Purnamikas, the ladies who were collecting them, were actually using this little app. And there, the compliance ratio went up substantially through the period of this pilot. I found this as a very simple, interesting, small thing that someone did, because from a technology standpoint, it's nothing big. You know, it's just a camera, someone taking a photograph, recognizing a QR code and giving a rating. But what excites me more about it is the way someone applied this solution and actually tested it out and sort of worked, right? I'm sure there are many issues with this, it can be made better. But there's something interesting that someone tried to do. And it was incidentally also an outcome of one such hackathon or designathon where people were trying to address some of these issues. This is a fairly, I do not know how many of you know about this, but this is an NGO that is working very hard in the waste processing space. Again, I have put it up because I've had a personal experience with these people. So I have been to their center. It's here, there are several centers. The one that I went to was in Kormangla. And the entire system is so streamlined, and they've done it with collaboration with BBMP, where huge amount of organic waste lands up at their collection center, and they are continuously turning that into manure and actually selling them. I went there purely because I wanted to buy it. The transaction was so clean. Everything seemed so well organized that actually made me really optimistic about these kind of things, where you can actually see a system working, where you've actually bought a byproduct of someone's idea of trying to make a difference. We all know about rainwater harvesting in Bangalore, but looks like Chennai did a very good job around it. So 2001 was when the then government made it mandatory, and they achieved almost 90% compliance very, very soon. And it actually, till date now, has made a significant difference to the groundwater table. And I'm sure, you know, Bangalore, if the compliance levels keep going up, we'll see a significant change in our groundwater table as well. I was in Singapore recently, And I found it fascinating. Singapore, one would associate with latest technology, fairly modern place and so on. Their government has decided that every footpath will be sheltered. Have a shelter. So it looks like that. So that's not a small thing. Can you imagine the scale of the project? So the government is saying that the future of transportation is walking, right? And when they do that, they are doing it with such intensity because it rains every now and then in Singapore, to make that convenient, and it's very hot. To make it convenient, they've got sheltered walkways throughout the city, and they've got some really aggressive targets about how much sheltered walkways and how many kilometers they're going to have in a very, very short span of time. The reason I found that fascinating was because normally when one talks about developed infrastructure, mostly people talk about metros, people talk about your monopods and all kinds of electric cars and all of that. Rarely do we acknowledge that we can easily walk for 2 kilometers without any problem, right? If there was a simple way to walk, you could walk and it'll solve many problems in one shot. And it's actually very cheap. The cost of actually just making a shelter on top of a footpath is not very expensive. But that needs to be recognized as an alternative. That needs to be taken very seriously for it to happen. And I was very glad to see something like this because it's like a no-brainer. Low tech, simple solution. Of course, closer to home and our office, I've seen a lot of people use carpooling apps, which I think is great. I put this up here because I thought, let's look at things that people are trying to do and people are using around us. And a lot of people are using, I have personally not used them, but apparently there are ways in which you can actually pool with people who are coming back or going from the office and actually map the destination, and actually seems to work pretty well because we have many people coming to our offices using these. At this point, it'll be nice if, if anyone wants to share any other story that you may know of and you may find worthy to actually sort of add, sort of put it into this inspiration bucket so that we can sort of start off with some of these inspiring stories which seem to have made some sort of a dent to the issue created by rapid urbanizing. Anyone?
Okay, hello. Hi, I'm Shombi. I'm a fashion designer and I work at Lifestyle. So recently one day we were walking down in our tech park and there were 4 guys who just stopped us and they were like, hello ma'am, do you have 2 minutes? So they were from this worldwide, what is it, the WWF thing, sure, that worked for saving animals and everything. So they just handed out some these pamphlets to us. And coming back in the cab, I was just going through it. And there were some facts which were stated in it and were really shocking. Like, they acted as an eye opener. So like, this is not anything that I have come across. It's, you can say it's a small initiative that I have taken for myself. So I read how they have talked about the waste that, we have been dumping in the oceans and how it's affecting the whole biological system, and then the forecast for the future, how it's going to affect. So then I took this small initiative and I stopped using plastic straws. So even when I go down for coffee or something, so I just borrow a used stirrer from a friend and I use it. So that's one initiative that I've taken for myself. And I carry my own bottles, so I don't have to. So, I could reduce using those paper cups and plastic bottles and stuff. That's it. I think it's very small, but even on a very small and individual level, we could do something. You know, it'll make you feel good as well. And on a larger scale, if all of us do small things, whatever you're capable of, it will for sure bring a difference. Sure. That's what I feel. So.
True. All right. Thanks. Yeah. Thanks for sharing that.
Hello. Yeah. I don't know what I'm going to say. You may connect it with what we have been talking,
sure.
But that makes me say this. The main core factor in the entire urbanization or the things what we're seeing are all the byproducts. But the main product here is the human. And the psychology is getting so much affected that the psychologically the human being is so much affected, and mentally, you know, there's so much trauma created. So if you see something like this, as she was talking just now, it is creating an internal learning for each one of us through design or through, you know, innovation or per se, which is, I think, another major area which we will have to now start addressing in terms of child psychology, adult psychology, or even the, you know, urbanites. Or so when you go to the rural place, we feel, you know, nice clean air and so forth. But when you come to the urbanization, I think people, interaction, communication are the other areas which we are unseen in this point of things, where design may work largely, is what I would say.
Yeah, thanks for bringing that up. While I was making this presentation, and it's a very, very important point, while I was making this presentation, I was putting the slides together, and I was putting slides of, you know, roads that had so much traffic, flooding, and what was going through my head was that it has to have an underlying impact on our brains. It has to. I mean, if you're seeing so much garbage, and if you're driving by garbage, it has to have an impact on your brain and your emotions. It has to. I mean, it's so logical. As a result, I was trying to see if there was research that was done to prove the correlation, because you know, you fortunately need some backing of numbers to actually prove what you personally feel. Because I feel personally disgusted, but I need to find statistics to prove that, you know, a lot of people are feeling disgusted. So I was trying to look into that. There are some studies that prove that there is correlation between the level of stress and the urbanization, right? So there is some amount of research. It's not very conclusive. That's the reason the slide is not up here. Not very conclusive, but it's quite convincing because it's so obvious. If you're not leading a good quality of life, you're likely to be a little more stressed. If you're not getting home on time, you will be stressed. And if you're stressed, that stress will be released somewhere else on someone else. And that person is going to be stressed. So on the whole, cases where the urbanization is not properly planned, managed, the stress levels are likely to show. There was one more correlation that I found. Again, I didn't put it up because it was not very conclusive. It wasn't as conclusive as smog, right? The other correlation was between the level of urbanization and crime in the city. So obviously, stress will find an outlet. Urbanization and the pace at which things are moving, and the fact that we are forcing humans to live in a certain kind of condition, will need some sort of outlet, and crime reflects that in some way. So there is poverty, inability to cope with, you know, a lot of money that is needed to survive in urban areas, lack of public welfare systems and support systems leads to crime. So there is, again, some amount of preliminary research done there, not very conclusive, or maybe there is something conclusive and I couldn't come across it. But thanks for highlighting the emotional aspect and the psychological aspect. That's really, really key.